Welcome to Survive the Jive. In the Gospel of Matthew, it is written that whatever you do for the hungry, the thirsty, or the stranger in need of shelter, you do for God. This teaching has encouraged compassion towards the less fortunate in Christian countries, but it is far from a Christian invention. The idea of a homeless beggar being the same as a god was believed in quite literally in many pagan cultures, in which the gods were frequently said to have disguised themselves as men in order to test the virtue of mankind. The earliest written example comes from ancient Greece, in Homer's writing, in which gods must disguise themselves to reveal themselves to men on earth. Odysseus says to Athena, "It is hard, goddess, for a mortal who meets you to recognize you, even if he is very intelligent, for you can disguise yourself as anything." Gods can easily recognize other gods, but mortals cannot. It is an inferior faculty of perception of the divine that distinguishes man from God. The common man is limited by the apparent and transitory reality he perceives with his senses, and he can only perceive gods when they make themselves sensible to him. However, the holy can perceive the gods through divine intuition. In Book 13, the heroic Odysseus fails to recognize Athena, but he also claims to have recognized her in a previous encounter. This shows that as a hero, he is close to the gods in divine perception, but not equal to them. In the hymn to Demeter, the goddess gets angry with Metaneira for not recognizing her, saying that she was blinded by her foolishness and adding that it is the ignorance of men that prevents them from knowing their fates. The motif of the god in disguise is widespread in Indo-European mythology. Very Indo-European. However, one of its most widespread forms, the god as beggar, is only depicted in the Odyssey in the context of the mortal hero Odysseus himself. When the hero finally returns to his native Ithaca and finds his house overrun by rude and entitled suitors who wish to steal his wife, Odysseus disguises himself as a beggar so that he can test their hospitality. Odysseus's friends perceive the heroic attributes of this beggar and extend the traditional courtesies of the honored guest to him, even though he appears outwardly to be a mere peasant. But the suitors fail to perceive that he is a man protected by Athena and treat him inhospitably. Ultimately, the suitors are punished for this and for their other transgressions. We shall see that this mythic trope repeats in a very similar function in other Indo-European myths. It is based on a tradition that is ubiquitous, not only among Indo-European peoples, but also among many others, such as the Arabs, Turks, and Chinese. In many cultures, the guest is revered and made to feel he is of a higher status than perhaps he really is. He is permitted to eat or drink first, is offered the most comfortable chair, and the host will go to great lengths to see the guest is comfortable and well fed. In such cultures, the accusation that the host had mistreated his guest would bring great dishonor on the household. In Indo-European cultures, it seems this tradition was believed to be enforced and tested by the gods themselves. In ancient Greece, it was called xenia, and in Latin, hospitium. The entire Trojan War happened partly because Paris failed to honor the concept of xenia. In ancient Greece, it was usually Zeus who played the role of beggar. In the Odyssey, it states that all strangers and beggars are under protection of Zeus, and Zeus was known under the epithet Zeus Xenios, Zeus protector of strangers, and Zeus protector of suppliants. The Roman poet Ovid wrote a long poem about supernatural transformations called Metamorphoses, which was based on both Greek and Roman mythology. The gods in the poem frequently interact directly with mortals, usually while in disguise, and they often turn their mortal victims into animals as punishment for one of the many things that can offend them. This means that for a pagan, any animal could be a transformed human, or a god in disguise, or a real animal. In each story, the gods reveal themselves only after a disguised interaction, at which point the mortals are taught a lesson, such as when the disguised Mother Leto transforms the inhospitable Lycian peasants into frogs for refusing to give her a drink of water. They did not honour the stranger, the guest, the traveller, Xenia, an impious and dishonourable act for a pagan. Another of these stories is about Baucis and Philemon, a heartwarming story of how Jupiter and Mercury, in mortal form, travelled around a swampy region of Anatolia, knocking on doors and asking for hospitality. They were rejected 1,000 times until they tried a tiny thatched cottage owned by a feeble and very poor old couple called Baucis and Philemon. Despite his poverty, Baucis welcomed the two guests and spread a dirty rug for them to lie on. He lit the fire with whatever leaves and twigs he could gather and prepared them a meal of cabbage and smoked pork. The Greek tradition of Xenia actually requires that the host provide the guest with a bath too, but poor Baucis could only offer them an old beechwood bowl filled with warm water in which to bathe their weary feet. The two disguised gods enjoyed long and easy conversation with the agreeable and generous old couple. Philemon even prepared a spread of olives, eggs, cheese, and fruit, and a bit of wine for her guest to enjoy after the meal. But as soon as the wine bowl was emptied, it miraculously filled up again by the power of the gods. And seeing this, the pious old couple turned their hands upward in prayer and said they would sacrifice their only goose as an apology for the crudeness of their hospitality. But the gods said no. "We will destroy this land as punishment for the wicked inhospitality of the people here, but you too will be spared." Jupiter then flooded the whole land and drowned everybody, but he transformed the old cottage into a magnificent temple with a golden roof, and he offered to grant the couple a boon of their choice. They asked only to be guardians of this new temple and of Jove's shrine within, and that each of them would be allowed to die at the exact same moment so that neither would have to ever live without the other. Jupiter granted them their wish, and after they served some years as temple guardians, they were each turned into trees, he an oak and she a linden, and they were thenceforth worshipped at those trees by the locals as gods. Tell this custom has Indo-European provenance because it is found in both India and Europe. The ancient Hindu texts say the host must offer the guest water to wash his feet, must feed him and provide a bed, and accompany him some distance when he leaves. This etiquette has been preserved for thousands of years in India and is still observed there today. I have been personally humbled and impressed by the hospitality of people in India and Sri Lanka. The custom resembles sacred rituals from the Rig Veda, in which the gods are received as guests and are offered food and drink. Take this prayer to the fire god Agni, for example. "The man who's sweating brings for thee the fuel and makes his head to ache, thy faithful servant. Agni, to him be a self-strong protector. Guard him from all who seek to do him mischief. Who brings thee food, though thou hast food in plenty? Welcomes his cheerful guest and speeds him onward. Who kindles thee devoutly in his dwelling, to him be wealth secure and freely giving." Mandala 10, hymn 17 of the Rig Veda also states that the man who shares his food with the hungry beggar will have everlasting riches and victory in battle, and makes a friend and ally of all to whom he is generous. The same sentiment is repeated in Book 9, Hymn 6 of the later Atharvaveda. "Verily, when a host looks at his guests, he looks at the place of sacrifice to the gods. When he salutes them reverently, he undergoes preparation for a religious ceremony. When he calls for water, he solemnly brings sacrificial water. The water that is solemnly brought at sacrifice is this same water. The libation which they bring, the sacrificial victim dedicated to Agni and Soma, which is tied to the post, that verily is this man. When they arrange dwelling rooms, they arrange the sacred chamber and the shed for housing the Soma Kars. Avratya is a kind of wild holy man in India, but at the time of the Atharvaveda, the word referred more generally to an outcast or criminal, someone you probably would not want to see knocking on your door. But one hymn in the Atharvaveda specifically imposes a duty of hospitality on those who receive Vratya as guests. Let him to whose house the Vratya, who possesses this knowledge, comes as a guest, rise up of his own accord to meet him, and say, Vratya, where didst thou pass the night? Vratya, here is water, let them refresh thee. Vratya, let it be as thou pleasest. Vratya, as thy wish is, so let it be. Vratya, as thy desire is, so be it. When he says to his guest, where didst thou pass the night? He reserves for himself thereby the paths that lead to the gods. When he says to him, here is water, he secures thereby water for himself. When he says to him, let them refresh thee, he thereby wins vital breath to exceeding old age. When he says to him, Vratya, let it be as thou pleasest, he secures to himself thereby what is pleasant. That which is pleasant comes to him, and he is the beloved of the beloved who is possessed of this knowledge. When he says to him, Vratya, as thy will is, so let it be, he secures to himself thereby the fulfillment of his will. Authority comes to him who possesses this knowledge, and he becomes the controller of the powerful. When he says to him, Vratya, as thy desire is, so be it, he secures to himself thereby the attainment of his desire. His desire comes to him who possesses this knowledge, and he gains the complete satisfaction of his wish. The implication, if you understand Hindu philosophy, is that any dirty Vratya who comes a-knocking could in fact be the Vratya, the god Shiva Rudra, who many scholars have equated with the Norse god Odin, whom I have much to say about later in this video. But there are other gods who fulfill the role of disguised beggar in Hinduism too. In the story of Vishvamitra, the legendary Harishchandra is forced to sell himself into bondage to a lowly, ugly man of the Chandala caste named Pravira, who it is later revealed was actually the god Dharma himself in disguise so that he could test him. And in another story, the legendary Brahmin Adi Shankara runs into a dark Chandala on the road who had with him four dirty dogs. But the great Brahmin gave way on the road for the lowly Chandala, which astonished the people who saw, until Adi Shankara explained that the Chandala was not simply a low-caste man, but an avatar of Shiva, and that the four dogs were in fact the four Vedas. So it was of course proper for him to give way. Moving back to Europe, in the Irish myth of the destruction of Da Derga's hostel, a dark, hairy, and hideous witch comes to the hostel one night and asks to enter, but the king refused on the grounds of a cultural taboo against receiving a female guest after sunset. The witch, who says her name is Caliph, but seems to be an aspect of the goddess Bath, insists on hospitality and refuses to leave, so King Conair offers her an ox and a cured pig if she will go away. But she then challenges his hospitality, saying she will go elsewhere, which prompts him to let the witch in despite the taboo. And this implies the duty of hospitality is stronger and more feared even than the witch who forebodes death. In Scandinavia, the highest of all the Norse gods was Odin. And there are many myths in which he wanders the earth in the form of an old man, usually one-eyed, testing the virtue of mortals. In all of Saga Tryggvasonar, the great Christian king Olaf, who hated pagans and often slaughtered them and burned their temples down, met a strange one-eyed man at a banquet in Ogfaldsness. The man wore a hood and was very eloquent and knowledgeable, regaling King Olaf about the great pagan king who had lived at Ogfald and was buried in the barrow there, and also of his sacred cow. All night, the king enjoyed the fascinating stories the old man told, and even after the banquet, the man stood at the foot of the king's bed and continued to educate him on the ancient pagan histories, until the bishop told Olaf it was bedtime, and the strange man had to leave. The next morning, the king wanted to hear more from the amazing man, but he was gone. But the cooks in the kitchen said he had come into the kitchen and told them that their meat was no good. And then he'd give them 2 fat sides of beef for the stew, which they had cooked with the other meat. Olafur then realized the beef was from the sacred pagan cow of old, and that the old man had been Odin, who had attempted to feed them the sacred meat of sacrifice. So he told them to throw all the food away so that Odin could not deceive them. This myth reveals the tension between pagan and Christian beliefs in the Viking era, but in another older myth found in the Eddic poem of Grimnismor, we see the more familiar Indo-European trope of the god as beggar testing hospitality. Odin and his wife Frigg disguised themselves as a couple of elderly rural peasants living by the coast, where it was fated the 2 sons of King Hrodung, who had been lost at sea when fishing, were to be washed up and forced to spend the winter. Odin took the younger son, Geirrod, as his foster son, and Frigg fostered the older son, Agnar. The following spring, Odin gave them a ship so they could sail home, but Odin whispered secret advice to Geirrod, so when the 2 boys reached home, Geirrod leapt out and pushed the boat, with his brother still in it, back out into sea and shouted, "Go where the trolls can take you." Their father was dead, so Geirrod became the new king, and his brother simply raised troll children with a troll wife in a cave. Looking down on the world and all these events from their throne, Hlidhjelf, Odin taunted his wife, whose foster son had failed, while his had prospered. But in response, she questioned Geirrod's observance of the sacred duty of hospitality. Odin said she was lying and made a bet with her that she was wrong. The bet was on. But Frigg then tipped the odds in her favour by sending her handmaid Fulla of the golden headband to arouse Geirrod's paranoia with a story about an evil wizard who could bewitch him, but who could be identified by the fact that no dog would be brave enough to jump up at him. Then, when a mysterious man in a blue cloak visited his hall and the dogs did not jump up at him, Geirrod had him tortured to find out who he was. But the man said only that his name was Grimnir, the hooded one. For 8 nights, Grimnir was made to sit between 2 hot fires with no food or drink, an inhospitable welcome for the travelling guest, until one night, Geirrod's son, named Agnar after his uncle, crept to the old man with a mead horn to quench his thirst. Grimnir, or should I say Odin, then declared that Agnar and not his father would rule in the land of the Goths, and that he would always have good luck. He also spoke sacred verses of the poem Grimnismor, which contain divine wisdom that would benefit Agnar and any pagan who learned them. But poor Geirrod, realizing too late that the old man was Odin, rushed to release him from the flames, but stumbled and fell on his own sword, killing himself, so that his son became king that very day. Odin himself explains clearly precisely what sort of hospitality a guest ought to expect in Hávamál, which is a poem contained in the Elder Edda. "Good luck to who gives, a guest has entered. Where should he find somewhere to sit? Very jumpy's the one who by the blaze must make a test of his luck. Fire is required by one who's entered and is chilled to the knee. Food and clothes are required by anyone who's journeyed over the fells. Water is required by one come to dine. a towel, and friendly welcome, a kind disposition, if it's to be had, speech and silence in return. The line saying, "guest has entered," refers not only to a random guest, but also to Odin, since guest is one of his many names, with the implication that any wandering traveller at your door could be Odin in disguise, especially if he wears a blue hood or has only one eye. Oh, sorry. Hold on a second. I just got to get this.
I'm sorry to trouble you, but could I have a little water and some food?
I'm very... Can't you see I'm busy? No.
I've travelled very far.
Sorry about that. The Icelandic sagas also contain examples of a host being obliged by force of custom to accommodate and feed guests, who may in fact be enemies. However, this duty of hospitality ends as soon as the morning comes and the guest departs, at which point it is permissible to kill them. Killing someone, even an enemy, while they are a guest in your home was considered extremely dishonourable. Even the gods abide by this tradition. In one myth from Skald Skapamor, the giant Hrungnir is permitted to enter the land of the gods, Osgard, where he is invited to drink. But the giant got drunk and abusive, even making threats of violence against the gods. At this point, the duty of hospitality no longer applied, so the gods called on Thor to deal with this unruly guest. Thor revealed then that he did not think that hospitality should ever have been extended to the race of giants in the first place. Thor and Hrungnir then engaged in a duel, with the result that Thor shattered the giant's skull with his hammer. This ancient Indo-European ideal of hospitality towards travellers must not be extrapolated to a wider political ideal. It certainly would not be considered necessary or right for the Anglo-Saxons to accommodate the Viking armies that were invading as though they were guests. It does not apply to the mass movements of people, nor can it be extended from the home to a wider duty of hospitality for the entire nation-state. The duty is only to accommodate a needy stranger in your home for the night, and then all obligations are entirely fulfilled, and you are free to treat them as an enemy if you wish. Also, the guest too is bound by certain obligations that, if neglected, would relieve the host of their duty of hospitality. In Hávamál, Odin warns guests not to drink too much, speak too much, eat too much, or to outstay their welcome. A big thank you to the four artists who provided original content for this video. You can check out their work by following the links in description. You should also check out the sources if you want to learn more about the topics from this video. Thanks for watching. You can also access exclusive private videos which I make just for patrons if you sign up for either Patreon or Subscribestar for as little as the price of a pint per month. The links for these are in the description. If you support me, you will be ensuring this channel continues to survive and celebrate ancient European history for years to come. So thank you so much.